For 14 seasons on Saturday Night Live, Darrell Hammond was best known, perhaps, for his impersonation of President Bill Clinton.
But suddenly, everything turns around, and he's able to achieve true greatness when aliens invade Earth and a helicopter crash kills his wife. I love this movie.
The lip-biting, thumb-wagging, more Clinton than Clinton act was almost a weekly occurrence. But Bill Clinton was just one of more than 100 celebrities Hammond would imitate with an uncanny ability. But behind the fame and fortune, he was struggling with flashbacks and emotional trauma, and with doctor after doctor misdiagnosing the cause, he turned to drugs and alcohol to cope. And now a new documentary called Cracked Up follows Hammond along that journey from depths of despair to the moment of realization.
A psychiatrist, I think it was number 11, said that I was a manic depressive.
You are schizophrenic.
I might be a multiple personality.
9 psychiatric facilities, including lockdown.
Well, I'll just give him these pills.
He goes, well, let's face it, you are a nut. He made me laugh. He's like, I'm joking with you because you're not any of these things. You are this way because of something that happened to you.
And Darrell Hammond joins us now from New York. So too, Michelle Esrick, producer and director of Cracked Up. Thank you both for coming in.
Thank you for having us.
Okay, Darrell, the good news is you're not a nut. What you are is a survivor of childhood trauma, memories which had been repressed for 50 years of some terrible abuse you'd suffered at the hands of your mother. You describe this as a hallelujah moment when you realised that you actually didn't have a mental illness, but a mental injury.
That I think there's probably a couple of hallelujah moments from at least in my life, and I've heard this from other people too. The first one is when you realize that you're this way because of something that happened to you, after spending a life of sort of being accused of choosing this or somehow being sullen. Like, people got angry at me because the teachers thought I was sullen. I had a bad attitude. No, I was impaired. I was kind of injured. And the second is that day when you become as powerful as your perpetrator. And that's a weird thing to say, but when you become as powerful as them or more powerful, I mean, you want to come at them. And I'm not a lawbreaker, and I don't know leg breakers. I can write,
Yeah.
So I wrote.
We meet again, you logger-headed, tickle-brained pumpkin. I cut an album of filthy limericks just so I'd be eligible. There once was a man named Trebek who had the world's tiniest...
Enough!
And there is a part in the documentary that we get to see the first time you talk about the flashbacks you were having as a 19-year-old, and this is a very powerful moment in the movie. I just want to take a quick look, and we'll talk about it on the other side.
First flashback. There is a floating red ball of light. This odd image produced a terror in me. And the terror would only stop if I cut my wrist. It basically creates a manageable crisis. I've got to attend to this blood, and the other image will go away.
You know, it wasn't just the cutting, it was, the alcohol and the drugs. But eventually you and your doctor worked out what was going on, and the key here was the color red, which represented your mother in a way.
Well, it represented all that I could remember about a specific incident in which I was bleeding. I mean, the way I understand it is, over a period of time, your brain more will be revealed, and it will reveal more to you. But in the beginning, all that was coming to me was sort of being possessed of the color red. I mean, at the time, the floor was red. But that's the only image that came to me, was red, that gradually, got a little clearer over time. It's almost like if you're looking at something on your computer and it hasn't downloaded all the way yet, is that the right word? Mm-hmm. And it's fuzzy, yeah. But it started out as just redness, yeah.
And Michelle, the documentary, it takes us on this journey with Darrell, and to me at least, the power in the storytelling here is how it all slowly
and painfully comes together to this moment sort of revelation, which as someone who watched it, it's a relief, it's shocking, it's awful, it's everything at the same time.
Yes, well, I wanted to try to create this experience that Darrell experienced for over 40 years. He had to live, he had to suffer not knowing what happened to him. And he had to live with the shame and the stigma and the misdiagnosis for 40 years. So I didn't want to tell right away what had happened to him in the beginning. I wanted to edit it in a way that the audience could, you know, it was like a mystery, because it was a mystery for him.
And it did seem to me that there was that one point in the documentary when everything comes together. And here it is.
My wife got pregnant. Baby was born. And then I heard my wife say, your mom called, and she said, hey, as a mommy, you're gonna need some breaks. So she said she would take the baby. My soul knew all along what had happened, and I didn't know until my child's life was now on the line.
And then Darrell, it seems after that, all of these repressed memories just came rushing out.
Yeah, it's funny because some of the, they're almost like icons on a computer screen that you don't quite open because they're, you know, the things that I remember and that I began to remember when my daughter was born were stuff that I thought was my fault, you know, because my brain could believe one of two things. A parent did this to me, or I'm bad. It's my fault. So there was the time, the really crazy thing of the time the hand is slammed in the door, my fault. I did that. I slammed the hand. I slammed it on myself because that's a kind of, because I'm a bad kid, you know? They used to say sullen, but they didn't say that in the South. They said sulled up. Mm-hmm. I was accused pretty often of being all sulled up.
Because but,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think that for those who have not experienced as a child abuse, emotional abuse and physical abuse from a parent, they don't know what it's like. They don't know that it's the cruelest, most painful abuse a kid can experience.
Yeah, and also, you know, it's interesting that the things that we can think about that make us feel bad, but nothing is really quite as nuclear as that thought. I'm not loved. They didn't love me. They looked at my brain once. The left side of my brain was dark. The right side of my brain was Times Square.
I think something that really struck me that Darrell and Darrell's doctor that saved his life, Dr. Cotby, said, but Darrell said, it's easier to believe that I'm bad than to believe that my parent doesn't love me.
The bigger picture here, though, in making this documentary is trying to take some of the stigma away or some of the shame away that, you know, comes with, I guess, mental illness or with trauma. There was this moment in the documentary, a conversation that Darrell had with his friend Larry, and that seems to speak to that. Here it is.
It's conceivable that someone could talk to Darrell about this and actually implant that thought in his mind that may not really have ever happened.
You know, it's what this doctor said. I remember saying to him when I left this hospital, I was like, how do you know I didn't make this whole thing up? And he said that children from healthy homes don't make up stories like that about their parents.
And Darrell, that's what really struck me. Children from healthy homes don't make this stuff up.
Yeah, even from homes where people are like making lots of mistakes and the family falls on hard times and there's all kinds of struggles that really mount up to a lot of honest mistakes. Loving the child, no. I don't believe they, the complete statement was, they don't make up things that would put their parents in prison. They wouldn't make up a story like that.
Michelle, one thing also about this documentary is that, you know, you tried to incorporate Darrell's humor, his comedy, you know, to tell a full picture of his life, because it's not just this dark side of Darrell, there's some incredibly funny moments as well.
Yes, well, humor helps us take our medicine. So Darrell is a comic genius, and
okay, all right, sure. That's okay.
Darrell's a comic genius.
All right.
And you know, so yes, I filmed him doing his stand-up, and There's clips from SNL where he's doing all his famous characters of Clinton and Sean Connery. And so I really spent a long time with my editors. We really wanted to weave the comedy and the tragedy in a way that helped make it the story tolerable for the audience.
You know him, he's the longest running cast member in Saturday Night Live history. Give it up for Darrell Hammond, everybody.
I used to drink absinthe in this enormous bar called Mexico.
Darrell, do you ever wonder what sort of person you would have been if you came from, you know, what people might call a normal loving family where you weren't abused by your mom?
Probably wouldn't have been worth a damn. I think, of course, I do, and I've thought about it a lot over the years. But after a while, I just realized that, I don't know, maybe something good comes out of it. But, I mean, once anyone that's been harassed or beaten up or bullied knows what it's like, because you're in the perpetrator contract. And the perpetrator contract is, I won't kill you, but I could, and I will, if you tell.
Yeah.
You know, and the day you become as strong as them, the second that happened, man, I got it right in my head off.
Namaste.
What does that mean? The divine in me salutes the divine in you. Do you think there is such a place?
It's a very powerful documentary. It is a great story. It certainly struck a chord for me. So thank you so much for what you guys have done.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.